In this video, I'm going to show you how to estimate the value of pi using only spaghetti. Here's how you do it. First, we use the spaghetti as a measuring stick to draw out a square grid. I'm only drawing one full square here, so you're just going to have to use your imagination and imagine it as an infinite grid. Then, we throw a bunch of pieces of spaghetti one by one onto the grid. The more pieces you use, the more accurate the estimate for pi will be on average. I threw 11 pieces here. Now we need to count up the number of times the spaghetti crossed one of the grid lines. In my case, I counted 14 crossings. Finally, the formula to estimate pi is this. Pi is approximately 4 times the number of noodles divided by the number of crossings. In my case, I threw 11 noodles and I got 14 crossings, so my estimate for pi works out to 22 over 7. Or, as decimals, 3.1428. To see how good this approximation is, you can use a computer to repeat the experiment millions of times. I made a separate video doing just that. In the rest of this video, I'm going to try to explain why the formula actually works. This problem is sometimes called the Buffon needle problem. Now, if you're like me, the first time you see this problem, it's completely bananas. Where did pi come from? I have straight spaghetti, it's going onto a square grid, there are no circles in this problem whatsoever. Pi is about the circumference of a circle. Where did the pi come from? And the reason I made this video is because I want to show you this one really weird math trick that shows you where the pi comes from. So it fully explains where the pi comes from, it explains where this constant 4 comes from in the equation, and there's no trigonometry or nasty calculus involved. So I really like this trick. And the trick is, and I'm being 100% serious when I say this, the trick is you have to cook the spaghetti. Now that we've cooked the spaghetti, when we throw it onto the grid, it's no longer just a straight line. It can be a curve of any shape. The problem of understanding what happens for arbitrarily shaped noodles is called the Buffon noodle problem. In math, what we've done is called generalizing the problem. You might think that this generalizing makes the problem harder. After all, the original straight spaghetti Buffon needle problem is just a special case of this new curvy Buffon noodle problem. But, counterintuitively, this more general problem is actually easier to solve than the original one. The key insight that unlocks the entire thing is to look at circular noodles. This was not possible before we cooked our spaghetti. Circular noodles will be at the core of our solution. But, like many math problems, we are going to have to peel back the problem layer by layer until we get to them. Fundamentally, the estimation works by comparing theoretical averages and experimental averages. To give a more familiar example, suppose that we were rolling dice instead of throwing noodles. The experimental average in this experiment is simply the sum of the dice rolled divided by the number of dice rolled. On the other hand, for an ordinary six-sided dice, we know that the theoretical average is simply the average of the sides. That's 3.5. Results from probability theory tell us that these two quantities, the experimental and theoretical average, are approximately equal. The infamous central limit theorem is one of these results. It tells us that the more dice we roll, the more accurate this approximation will be. In the Buffon noodle problem, we are throwing noodles instead of dice, but the principle is exactly the same. The experimental average is just the number of crossings divided by the number of noodles. And the theoretical average turns out to be 4 divided by pi. This will be explained later on in the video. Since these two are approximately equal, we can rearrange the equation to get our approximation formula for pi. The next thing we have to explain is why the theoretical average is 4 over pi. To see this, we are going to compare straight noodles to curvy noodles. The most natural question to ask here is, how does the average number of crossings depend on the shape of the noodle? The surprising answer is that it only depends on the length of the noodle. To get an intuitive understanding of why this might be true, imagine we have two noodles that are the same length, but one is curvy and one is straight. Now imagine that we cut both noodles into tiny, tiny pieces. Even though the curvy noodle was curvy, if we cut it into small enough pieces, each piece is approximately straight. Here's the brilliant idea. Since the noodles are thrown randomly, moving these little pieces and rotating them around won't change the average number of crossings for each piece. So we can rearrange the pieces of the curvy noodle into the same exact shape as the other straight noodle. This idea of cutting the noodles into tiny pieces shows why the two noodles must have the same average number of crossings. I made a separate video with a more rigorous version of this argument if you want to see the details. The same cutting into tiny pieces argument actually shows us that the average number of crossings is proportional to the length of the noodle. That is to say, there is a universal constant C, so that the average number of crossings is equal to C times the length of the noodle. If we can somehow find a way to calculate the value of C, then we can solve our problem by simply plugging into this equation. Because C is a universal constant, we only need to find a single nice example to calculate C. As promised, this is where we're going to use circular noodles to our advantage. Imagine a circular noodle of diameter 1. This fits perfectly into our square grid. Here's the miraculous fact. No matter how this circle lands on the grid, no matter how we move it, it will always have exactly 4 crossings. This means that for this particular noodle, the average number of crossings is definitely 4. On the other hand, the length of the noodle is the circumference of the circle, which is just pi. Rearranging the equation gives us what we're looking for. C is 4 over pi. We've gone several layers deep into this problem now, but finally we are ready to zoom back out and see the entire solution from start to finish. Remember that we want to explain why our original pi estimation formula works. Let's see all the steps we did in one slide. Our first important observation was that the average number of crossings is proportional to the noodle length. We argued that this was true by cutting the noodle into tiny pieces. This gave us a nice formula to work with that depended on a constant C. Next, by using a special circular noodle of diameter 1, we discovered that the constant C must be 4 over pi. The pi appears because it's the circumference of the circle, and the 4 appears because this circle always has 4 crossings no matter how it lands. Now, in our original experiment, the spaghetti was 1 unit long, so we can plug in length equals 1 to see that the theoretical average number of crossings is 4 over pi. By the laws of probability, the experimental average is approximately equal to this too. This gives us a nice approximation we can work with. Finally, all we have to do is rearrange the equation and solve for pi. It's also possible to prove this formula using trigonometry and integrals, but I hope you can see from this proof how generalizing the problem from the straight Buffon needle problem to the curvy Buffon noodle problem unlocks this beautiful proof, which directly explains how the constant pi and the constant 4 appear in the formula. As an added bonus to what we've done so far in the video, we can come up with a very clever proof of Barbier's theorem. Barbier's theorem states that every curve of constant width 1 must have a perimeter of pi. Here are some such shapes of constant width. There is no obvious way to construct all these shapes, and in general, they can be quite complicated. The classical proof of Barbier's theorem is pretty hard. However, in our noodle setting, there's a very easy proof. Think of these curves as a noodle thrown onto the grid. Because they're constant width, these curves always have exactly 4 crossings. By our proportionality result, because the number of crossings is always 4, and because the constant C is equal to 4 over pi, all of these curves must have perimeter pi. It really is just like the method we used to calculate the constant C using a circular noodle, but applied in reverse. This weird noodle-throwing problem has computed pi for us and proven a theorem. I wonder what other unexpected applications there could possibly be.